Let's talk about life. If you look back into the past decade of how our search for life has dramatically evolved in the solar system, there are a couple of factors which spurred that evolution. And that, on the one hand, our simulation and laboratory techniques got better and better in terms of emulating, you know, early Mars in a laboratory chamber, in a vacuum chamber on Earth, into orbital platforms, which taught us that there are organisms which are, you know, even multicellular organisms like tardigrades, which are able to survive for years and years and years in orbit, and you just rehydrate them once they come back, and you have this little water bear that's a tardigrade basically, and it's stretching out his legs again, it's revitalized. So these are extremely resilient organisms, where on Earth we have learned that life is much more capable than what we thought about 10 years ago. I mean, there are, you know, bacteria in gold mines 3 kilometers below the surface. There are bacteria which thrive in nuclear power plant cooling chambers, for example. I mean, that's really amazing. And so when you combine that fact that you have life which is just barely surviving under extreme conditions, and on the other hand, search for those locations where exactly those conditions are met in planetology, you have the very spots where you would want to look for life if it ever evolved there. Now, what are the places to look for? Right now, we know about 8 places in the solar system which have liquid water, and we somewhat have the gut feeling that liquid water is a necessary prerequisite, as it's a very excellent solvent, and there are many ways why we think that water makes sense. Now, not all of those areas are accessible, but one thing we learned is that most of those areas are outside the habitable zone. Now, what does it mean? Habitable zone is the distance from the sun where a planet can sustain liquid water on the surface. It's not too hot to evaporating, and it's not too cold to be freezing. Now, this is a zone which starts just before the Earth and just ending after Mars. This concept of this habitable zone, or Goldilocks zone as it's also called, is something where I honestly have a little bit my doubts if this is the right way to search for life. Because if you look into the outer moons of the Saturn system, the Jupiter system, you have Enceladus, the moon Enceladus at Saturn, or the moon like Europa at Jupiter, for example, they are clearly outside this habitable zone. Nevertheless, they have heat sources which we haven't thought about previously, like the tidal heating, that because of the frictional forces of the Lagrange forces, when you're coming closer and less close to the planet, that you're actually mangling through this entire core of the moon, and with that having the power source for sustaining oceans for a long time. And we see those oceans. We see cryogeysers on Enceladus, which are spitting out water from the liquid subsurface, for example. So if I would make a second wish to Santa Claus, it would be ice diving on Enceladus, for example. And we even have a spacecraft, the Cassini mission, which went to one of those plumes with a daredevil maneuver, where it was flying so close to Enceladus that it could actually go through one of those plumes and actually analyze the composition, going into, you know, helium ratios or deuterium tritium ratios for the hydrogen, for example, to actually determine where that water comes from. And the bottom line on this is it's the same water we would, or almost the same water we have on Earth here as well. So it means that the genesis of our world when it comes to water is very similar to the water out there. And that gives hope, because it means that the chemistry has been pretty much the same. There was both locations had also all the elements and all the physics in a similar way to create life, and they had also a lot of time. So the question is, what if life emerged there as well? We probably wouldn't see it up at the surface if there's something swimming around in the ocean so far. So it's a really exciting time. Also, that not just the planets and the moons which have this liquid water, but like Ceres. We are right now approaching a time where the Dawn mission is delivering us data from Ceres that we're still in the very early analysis stage here. In principle, it could maintain liquid water, because if you add a little bit of salt to it, depending on what kind of salt you're meaning, you can have freezing points at minus 60 degrees Celsius. And that makes it very interesting, because these are temperatures which we have on Mars, which we have on Ceres as well. That means there could be liquid water. And speaking of Mars, now, here we have a stampede of data coming from the red planet, and we're barely able to keep up with the pace of the data delivery. We knew water is on Mars for many decades. Just look at through a small amateur telescope and you see their polar caps. Now that's the ice part. That's something nobody talks about, it seems so. But we know there's permafrost. We know there are glaciers on Mars. There have been actually some measurements done by a ground penetrating radar by the Ferrari instrument on board of the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter and the Marsis instrument on board the European Mars Express mission, which indicate that not only on the poles themselves, but also in more lower latitudes, we have at least ices. And if you have ice with the correct salt mix, again, you would have the opportunity for liquid water. So we realized that Mars is becoming a wetter planet the longer we look at it. So if you compare the early picture of Mars, like, you know, in the 70s, it was a dry, boring desert. It is not. We know that for sure. There are even traces of hydrological cycles, because the Martian axis is not very stable, because it doesn't have substantial mass moons which are able to stabilize the rotation. Phobos and Deimos are just too small to do that. So what we see is an axial tilt. So we call this the Milankovitch cycles, that every 300,000 years, the axis tilts up to 60 degrees and is almost pointing with the poles towards the sun, which means you're melting up the entire poles, which means you're releasing a lot of water in the atmosphere. It gets much wetter. The atmospheric density actually is multiplied. There's a lot of energy you put into this. And so you have snowfall on Mars, you have even rivers on Mars for a short amount of times. And so you're recurringly create situations which are able for the proliferation of life. Now the question is, where do you look for? Of course, first of all, the places where water has been available for a long time. So you're looking at places where you have those tracer minerals like phyllosilicates, like olivines, which only get into existence when they're in long-standing contact with water, like at least, you know, millennia and millions of years sometimes even. And we found them. So we didn't know they were there, but already we're so good at it, or MSL or the MRO instruments are so good at it, that they are able to track those phyllosilicates from orbit, which is really impressive. I think the most stunning measurement, which has been greatly debated in the community, was the methane measurements, which have been around for a couple of years now. There have been some measurements from Earth, from ground-based observatories from Hawaii, for example. There have been some measurements done by the planetary Fourier spectrometer on board the Mars Express mission, for example. And there even have been ground measurements done by MSL. So why is methane so interesting? Now, methane is a chemical, a CH4, which is very simple. And we know it's a very common byproduct of biological activity. Now, I'm not saying that biological activity is the only way how to produce methane. I mean, you can put it in with impacts, for example, although we don't see enough recent impacts on Mars to account for this amount of methane. There's a second process where there's certain geological conditions being met, what we call the serpentinization, where you can also produce methane when you have an active geology going on. But the third explanation is already life. So we didn't know what to account it for. We could say, well, it's been, you know, ancient methane. But that's impossible, because methane has a very short half-life on Mars. We're talking about, like, you know, 400 years in the order of magnitude. That means whenever methane is created and we see it now, it must be a recent source. It's not, you know, an archaeological source of methane. And then there were some indications, although the data of validity is a little bit debated, that there might even be seasonal changes. I mean, that cries out for life when geology doesn't care about the seasons. Yeah? But the bottom line to this is we just don't know. But having boots on the ground in areas where you have a chemical sniffer in the form of the SAM instrument on board and other instruments on board the Mars Science Lab Curiosity gives us a unique chance to have a long-term measurements on ground methane. And in the first weeks when they first downloaded the data from the methane sniffer, it was pretty disappointing. There was nothing. It was below the threshold. And then, like a couple of months ago or so, MSL was actually driving through a plume of methane. And we were like, oh my gosh, this is much more than we expected. A few days afterwards, it was gone again. So where did the plume come from? But a sudden release. Could have been life, could have been whatever, non-biological. Again, we just don't know it. We by far haven't answered the question if they're, where to look for life on Mars. If I would have the choice, I would actually go down to the caves. Because they are so stable from the climate, they're so stable from the water ice resources. If there's water ice down there, it's shielded from micrometeorite bombardment. It's shielded from radiation, for example. So that's a place where to go, I would suggest too. If you are not a big Mars fan, there are other places to go for as well. And we are more and more discovering that the second asteroid belt we have, the Kuiper belt outside the orbit of Neptune, is indeed a place to watch out for. It's just that our techniques are not so much advanced that we're able to detect all the objects out there. They're pitch black dark and against a black background. Even with infrared, they're not very well visible, so they're really hard to detect. We believe there are up to literally billions of objects out there, with some of them, you know, Pluto-sized and more. And of course, you would say, well, there's no way you could have liquid water out there because there's no tidal heating out there, or much too far away from the sun to have some significant warmth. But never to know, because a couple of years ago, it was with one of the first Cubiwanos, one of the larger Kuiper Belt objects, the trans-Neptunian objects, where we realized there is a spectral signature that was found, which is indicative of hot ices, which, you know, ices come in various forms, depending on what kind of freezing temperature, what kind of cooling time there was, and so on. And so by getting a spectral signature of the type of ice, you can determine what kind of history that ice had, roughly. And what we realized there was at least one object where there was an ice which was much too warm, as it would have been allowed by the far distance from the sun. So we believe that there are still objects out there which might have some residual heat from nuclear heating, for example, if you know some very old thorium or whatever radioactive material you want to take care of. There's a number of materials out there which might have sustained a long-term heating process, maybe even so hot that it could sustain liquid water. So you don't even need a sun out there. You don't even need a central planet for tidal heating out there to still have liquid water. So if we then extend the search even beyond that, beyond the solar system, to extrasolar systems, and we don't, a couple of thousands of them already, at least candidates, thousands of them, we should definitely not limit our search to the planets which are in the Goldilocks zones, because as we see in our own solar system, more of the liquid water locations are outside the habitable zone, actually. So I think we have to revisit our presumptions about what life needs and where those conditions are met. And so I think it's a really interesting time to live in, to see the period when we are able to detect the first Earth-like planets, and we are just about to get there. And I would predict, and this is a very bold statement now I'm doing here, but I would predict that within a lifetime, we will detect the first Earth-like planets where we know there is an ocean and an atmosphere. And if once we're there, the next step would be, okay, what does the atmosphere look like? And so maybe we one day find a planetary atmosphere where we have a very peculiar spectroscopic signature which tells you the isotope ratios are strange, weird, not what you would expect from that particular central star to be the origin of those isotope signatures. And I think we have a good chance of one day, by this very mean of a spectroscopic analysis of an alien atmosphere, which we cannot do, barely can do yet now, is the first hint of life outside the solar system. I think the first hint for aliens will not be the spacecraft landing in our backyard and with bipedal aliens stepping out and saying, take me to your leader. I think the first hint of alien life will be a weird spectroscopic signature, which will be discussed for years until somebody comes up with a solution. Well, it can only be life. I think this is a very subtle change in our perception, but in the end it would mean that the last bastion of anthropocentrism, that Earth was formerly in the center of the universe, then it was our sun in the center of the universe, then it was our galaxy in the center of the universe, the last bastion we have here is that the humans are, the Earth is the only living planet in the universe. I think this barrier we're gonna see fall within our lifetimes.